The active medium of a laser can be of different phase. It can be actually any phase. I start with introducing gases. So this would be a typical setup for a gas laser. You have a gas reservoir, and in this there are two very flat on this glass reservoir that you can coat to become a mirror. So this is going to become the resonator of the laser. And most of the times the gas lasers are pumped through some discharge. So you just connect high voltage between the cathode and the anode, and the discharge can pump the atoms or molecules in the gas reservoir to an excited state, and then you can find some amazing transition. One of the most known gas lasers is the helium neon laser. There is a mixture of helium and neon atoms in this gas reservoir, and we excite the helium atoms through this discharge, and then through collisions, some of the energy of the helium atoms can be given to neon atoms, and in this way we can populate higher energy levels of neon atom, and this is the transition between these two states, which corresponds to an energy difference of a photon of 632 nanometers, and this is where the helium neon laser is being operated. From this ground state, there is a very fast decay to an even lower energy level. This way, it's provided that we have a very few number of atoms in this lower level of the basic transition. And this is how we achieve the population inversion, that by some mechanism we empty the lower level out of the tube, and this is how we can have a higher number of atoms in the excited state. I give here a few examples of the mediums that are used in gas lasers. It can be noble gases or noble gas mixtures. I just mentioned helium neon. Sometimes these are ions that are used, kryptonium and argon ion. You can also use molecules in gas lasers. CO2 laser is very well known, or metal gas vapors. There is also a very special type of gas laser, which is called excimer laser. There is quite a few at the high intensity laser laboratory Hill that I've seen in the program you are going to visit. They specialize in excimer lasers. Excimer is a molecule which is made up of at least two species, and the molecule is only existing in its excited state. If it would go down to the ground state, it would dissociate to the two species it's made up. die has a very broad bandwidth. I have here a few dyes and the spectra of them, which means that within this bandwidth we can choose which wavelengths we want the laser to operate at. So these are very easily used, these active media, for tunable lasers. The architecture of a dye laser is that we have some dye solution in a glass cuvette. We place it in between two mirrors to ensure that the laser light propagates back and forth. And we illuminate it with some other light from the side. And if we use a cylindrical lens, it means that we can have an active volume which is pumped up in a line, usually along the propagation of light between the two reflectors. And depending on what dye we put into the cuvette and how we set up the laser, we have different wavelengths of light. I just have two examples here, Modamin 6G and Coumarin. You see how different their color is, because they can operate at different wavelengths. The pumping, the population inversion in this case is, as I said, done by illumination of sunlight, and this illumination of sunlight is usually another laser. Why would you use one laser to pump the other laser? You already have a laser. Why do you go into trouble of building something? Because the second laser have different properties. It might be the tunability for the dye laser, because you set it up, you have some constant wavelength radiation, which is absorbed by this light, you reach population inversion. And depending on how you set up your optical components in the dye laser, you can tune the wavelength, you can pick different wavelengths. Also, if you have a broad bandwidth and you you produce this the laser light, in the laser light you produce different components, you might be able to make a shorter pulsed beam than what was in your original laser. Solid state, as I said, the laser material can be of any state. If it's a solid state laser, the architecture can be again this simple, as I showed in case of a groupie laser. We have a crystalline or glass rod that is doped with the atoms that we that has the required energy state, so they can be used for the laser operation. This type of laser is usually pumped optically, so we illuminate it with light, usually with flashlights. So this is not coherent light, not a laser light like we had for the dye laser. Fourth type of laser is when we have the laser medium as a diode. These are probably the most spread types of lasers, because they are very small, they are very cheap, and you can find commercially available any laser from the ultraviolet to the infrared regime fitting to your needs. And actually these lasers are also tunable. By tuning the temperature, you can tune the wavelengths of the light being emitted. And one of the recent innovations is when the laser is based on an optical fiber. So you couple in light to an optical fiber to take it anywhere you wish to. And they figured out that by choosing properly the optical fiber material, you can also dope it with atoms or molecules. Am I sitting on it? It's my friend. Then you can have actually an extremely long interaction, an extremely long amplification length. You can have kilometers of optical fibers, which will be the laser, and then you can actually coil it up, so very space preserving. And yeah, these fiber lasers are now the new money or leisure, you have to be aware of what type of mirrors you can use. The beam is going to diverge naturally, and you have to compensate for this divergence by a curved mirror, for example. So the laser is the active medium is placed in an optical resonator, and the aim of this resonator or oscillator is to provide the well-defined frequencies, the well-defined wavelengths that our laser will emit in form of the laser pulses. I have here an analogy. If you have a pendulum, depending on the length of the pendulum, there is a very well-defined frequency this pendulum can swing. And usually, after a few swings, the amplitude of the oscillation will decrease. So if you want to keep up for a very long time the same amplitude, the same oscillation, you have to push it each time. You have to keep putting some energy in. And this is how you can achieve a very well-defined wavelength. So also for the lasers to have a very specific, very well-defined frequency, which is provided by the resonator, you have to keep pumping in energy. And I said that I would like to make an analogy with a standing base. So depending on the resonator length, certain amounts of wavelengths, certain amounts of frequencies can be amplified, because in each pass you only amplify if the integer number of wavelengths fits into the length of your resonator. So basically, if you have a resonator, then this would support frequencies that fulfill this, that an integer number of wavelengths fits into the length of the resonator. I had here something that I covered up with unintentionally with this figure. I just wanted to say that the standing waves in a 1 meter long resonator, which is typical for a laser. I wanted to give you some numbers and some equations. So the typical length of a resonator is about 1 meter, and if we consider some visible light coming out of the laser, let's say this 500 nanometer, then it means that there are 4 × 10⁶ times the wavelengths of this light would fit into the resonator. So we are talking about millions. When I say that it has to be an integer number, millions of numbers, the wavelengths of light would fit into the length of the resonator. Nevertheless, these are the frequency components, so it could be 4 million, 4 million plus 1, 4 million plus 2, and so on, that fits into the resonator. And these are the frequency, this is a frequency comb, which is supported by this resonator. For the lights to be amplified. So this is what usually happens in a laser, that based on the resonator length, there is this frequency spikes that can be amplified in the resonator. And we also have the active medium that supports a certain bandwidth that you can amplify depending on the energy levels of the medium. And then you convolute the two, so you take underneath the gain curve what frequency spikes appear, and this is actually what is going to come out of the laser. Sometimes you are happy that you have more than one spike in the laser, because it means that you have a broader bandwidth of radiation, and this is what's going to happen if you want to make a short pulse. I'll come back to it later. But sometimes single component that you want to use, for example, for spectroscopic use. In this case, you can induce additional optical components into the resonator, and these additional optical components will also support the amplification of certain frequencies, and then you can reach that from the resonator modes, what is supported by this point etalon, and the laser gain curve, there could be just a single frequency that is at the output of the laser. But usually you have a few frequency components which are emitted from the laser. And the fourth component I've mentioned in the laser architecture is this output coupler, which is a partially reflecting mirror that you have to have the transmittance so that you can use the light that you're producing in your resonator. This reflection is sometimes 90, sometimes 99.5%, so this is again, as you have to make a balance of keeping enough light in the resonator so that the amplification takes place, but you have to get something out because this is something that will be at your use. The wavelengths, the available wavelengths, I have already shown a similar figure, depends on what active material you use, but you can cover anything from the UV to the infrared that is suitable for your needs, for your experiments. I have already said that at ELI we are having high power lasers, so now I come to classifying the lasers to different types. Now not based on the active medium, but based on how they emit the radiation. There are two major types, continuous mode and pulsed mode lasers. Continuous mode, as the name says, is that you turn it on and then you start getting the light out, like this pointer, I turn it on and then until I turn it off, it produces light continuously. For pulsed mode, again, the name says everything, it's like flashing. But it's not flashing the way I turn on and off this laser pointer, because these pulsed mode lasers have very short pulse durations, and then there is some silence, and then another blink. Just a typical example of an neodymium YAG laser. This is how we call a laser based on the active medium. So you know that this is a solid state laser where the YAG crystal is doped with the neodymium to get the lasing the active medium. This could provide a pulse train, so flashes of light, that the flashes are 20 nanoseconds long, so 10 times, 2 times 10 to the minus 8 seconds long, and in between two flash, there is something like 0.1 second. So each second, it will flash 10 times, but there is a very long distance in time between two spikes compared to the duration of the pulse. Why is it advantageous to have these pulse trains instead of the continuous operation? Well, they are advantageous for many causes that I will uncover later. First, I tell you how you can make your laser to operate in a pulsed mode. Basically, if you have two monochromatic waves and you add them together and they have a slightly different frequency, what you observe is called beating. This is the modulation of intensity. Probably you heard this experiment when you studied physics. And luckily, we have many materials that can amplify the laser light, that can lace at broad bandwidths. Probably the most exploited one is titanium sapphire. Again, it's a sapphire crystal doped with titanium. And the short pulse lasers, the first ones started to exploit this active material. So having a broadband amplifying scheme and put it into a resonator, we have several frequency components. And this bears the promise that we can combine these different frequency components to produce short pulses. Each of these would be infinite in time, just a sinusoidal wave. But if you add these different frequency components together, you can actually make short waves. If these different components are added with random phase, random delay with respect to each other, what you would get is kind of a noise, so continuous operation. But if you start all of them in phase, if you combine them, then you get this constructive interference of them at equal times, equal periods, and then you can have very short pulses. This locking of the different components, the different modes, the different frequency components, can be done in very different ways, very different techniques. It can be externally to the cavity, it can be made by internally in the cavity. You can even do a modulation of the pumping of your active medium to achieve this locking of the different components. So you see that originally I said that there are only four things you need to build a laser: the active medium, the pumping, and the two mirrors at the end of the resonator. But I'm adding more and more non-trivial components, like the phase locking, that is really needed to have the laser building. So before you go home from my talk and you start putting your own laser together in your backyard, I suggest that you read the whole book of laser physics. So there is a quest for shorter and shorter pulses in laser physics, and one reason for making shorter and shorter pulses is because it's very well published if you make something which is shorter than others are making. And you can see here the trends that depending on the active medium, solid, dye, lasers, there is an improvement with time of getting shorter and shorter pulses. Actually, the whole idea, the whole theory of how this short pulse laser can be made were already known by 1970. So this is that you need a broad bandwidth medium and you need to have mode locking, and I haven't mentioned it before, but dispersion within the cavity also have to be managed. And the improvement of the shortness or the reduction of the pulse duration came by finding better materials. Better materials for lasing, you see here the different ones, and better materials for dispersion management. So this is about the technology, the background, and finally I get to the point why we would need these short pulses. There are two reasons to go for shorter pulses. One is you want to concentrate your energy, which is in your laser beam, and you know that if you divide energy by time, you get power. So if you reduce time, then your power is going down. So if you want to have an intense interaction between your laser beam and your material, you want to increase the power of your radiation, one possibility to go short. The other reason why you would go for shorter pulses, because you might want to study fast processes, and to study fast processes you take snapshots of the dynamics, and the shorter your flash, the quicker, the faster process you can image. This is how picturing fast processes evolve. If you want to study a process which where something happens typically on a millisecond time scale, then you can use a mechanical shutter. If you want to study something where the typical time scale of your process is in the microsecond to the nanosecond, then you can do an electronically synchronized flash. You keep your field there all times, you don't use an aperture, but you only illuminate what is happening with your very short flash, and then you can capture different phases of the motion. There are two things here. It has to be synchronized, because it does mean if you flash at the wrong time, you are not capturing what is happening, and the flash has to be very fast. Both of these are combined in what's called laser pump probe technique, where you have a laser pulse that you split into two. One is used to initiate a process, and the other is used to see, to test, to probe the system, and to be able to say what difference has happened during the time it took for between the pump and the probe. And you can do the synchronization by sending the two pulses on different optical passes. So a few micrometer longer distance in one arm of an interferometer would result in a few femtosecond delay between the two pulses. And having very short pulses, you can also use this very short flashes. So this is the idea, that you have a pulse that you split to two, and then you have a pumping pulse that goes straight to the system to initiate some process that you want to study. And then you have another replica of this pulse. You send it on a somewhat longer pulse, not very much, but a little bit longer pulse. And then studying as a function of the delay, the absorption of this material, for example. You can study what chemical process the system went under, initiated by the first pulse. And it's also true that the smaller the system you want to study, the quicker it can move. So, for example, if you want to study what atoms are doing in molecules or solids, the typical length scale is the nanometer, and the typical time scale is picosecond, sub-picosecond. If you want to do something smaller, like the electrons, and you want to study what the electron does in nanostructures, molecules, or atoms, you are now aiming for smaller spatial extension at the same time what is happening must be maybe much quicker. So this is where you go to the femtosecond and attosecond regime. So what we are doing with these femtosecond laser pulses and our attosecond pulses is studying electronic motion in different spheres. An illustration of a big object and a small object, and during the opening time of my camera shutter, there is no blurring of the big object because it's only the small object that has been moving too fast to be captured. And why is it interesting what electrons do? Why do we want to study electrons? Well, we want to study electrons because many things rely on electrons. All the chemical bonds, they rely on electrons. If you think about what is an ionic bond, what is a covalent bond, they all rely on the electron doing something. Also, the signal transfer in even biological systems relies on some electrons. Also, I have here a movie, a cartoon, of what might happen if you induce locally an electron too much electron, too little electron. So you, for example, ionize this big molecule locally, and this ionization can be done by light, for example. Just you irradiate it with XUV light, you get an electron off. And this local electron excess might be used in diagnosis to check what the molecule, what form, what structure the molecule took up, or by knowing how you can remove that electron that will induce the structural change, it could be used in therapy. So the powerfulness of a laser relies on how much energy we have in a laser pulse and how short this pulse is. So again, I have here some numbers. The pulse laser is operating, producing a pulse train. Here I have this example where we have 35 femtosecond of laser pulses separated at 0.1 second, which means that this laser is working at 10 hertz. Every second it flashes 10 times. And then these are the typical values that you can deduce from these values. Joule per square centimeter is the fluence of light. The peak power is given as you divide the energy by the pulse duration. And you get the intensity if you take the energy divided by the area and divided by time. So this is how strong your light is, the intensity, how intense your light is. And I'd like to say just some words about peak power and average power. Basically, peak power is when you look at energy divided by time during the small flash, and average time if you average it over. So then you take how many pulses in each second you have and multiply the energy per pulse and divide by 1 second. So for example, this laser system that I think I took the, some pulse properties comparable to something which is at the top level of university laboratory laser systems. You can reach a peak power of 1.7 10 to the 12 watts, whereas your average power is below 1 watt. The importance of this comparison is that the interaction that you bring your laser into will be relying on how much is the peak power, whereas the average power will tell us how much load is on the optical components, because some of it will be absorbed, how much power we need to get from the mains, from the main plug to operate the laser. So to get peak powers that exceed thousands of the power that is available in whole country, you don't need to have that much power coming out of the main plug, because this is very short time while we have this peak power. And to illustrate how intense this field is, again, I have the previous laser's example. So I'm taking this 35 millijoule and I focus it down to a 100 micron diameter spot, which means that I'm reaching some intensity that might not mean very much to you. But I'm comparing it to, you know that light is an electromagnetic field, so there is an electric field strength. And from this intensity, I can calculate what is the field strength in this focus of the laser spot. And I get this value 10 to the 11 volts per meter. And if I compare it with the Coulomb field in the hydrogen atom, how much the Coulomb field is that binds the electron to the nucleus, I get the same order of magnitude. So what we can do with these university lasers is we shine it onto a material and we ionize, because the field experienced by the electron in this electromagnetic field is equal to or stronger than the electric field binding it to the ionic core. So this is what we can initiate with these lasers. Now at ELI, the lasers are going to be much more powerful. So whatever we shine that laser light on, it will evaporate, it will ionize, it will blow up. What we are studying is how it will happen, how the process of blowing up will happen. These intensities that I'm mentioning is also equivalent to collecting all the sunlight and focusing it down to your point. I'm reaching the end of my talk and I still haven't talked too much about the use of lasers in medicine, but I think the whole week will be devoted to this topic. So I'll just give a very few examples that I want to connect to the special properties of light that I have mentioned. I've mentioned to you that the laser light is very monochromatic, which means it can address very specifically certain materials, for example, certain tissues. So if you use lasers in dermatology, you can distinguish between addressing hemoglobin or melanin or water components of your body. And this you do by looking at the absorption spectra and finding the wavelengths where one is absorbing and the other is not. So this is why monochromaticity of laser is very important when you want to use it. The narrow bandwidth. I think you will get a talk by Professor Bari about how you measure circulation. And again, if you have a very specific wavelength, then you can measure any deviation from this very specific wavelength, and from that you can actually say how much is how strong is the circulation in the addressed tissue. The high power that you can reach with the lasers can be used to fragment stores in internal parts of the body, or in laser surgery to cut very nicely with your laser knife. Laser spectroscopy is also something that you will hear about. Here, using the monochromaticity of the beam, the tunability, low divergence, and short duration could all be exploited, because if you have a very narrow bandwidth, then you can very precisely scan the absorbers or the reflectors, emitters of your tissue, and even the short duration can be exploited if you look at what is the temporal evolution of the light which is being emitted after it absorbed something. Coherence of the laser beams I have mentioned. This is the ability of interfering both of different parts of the light beam. And again, this is something that you can use in circulation measurements. I'm sure you'll hear about it more. Laser eye surgery. Here we use the very precise shaping of the laser beam. So someone measuring the shape of your